This is Rosa Shaw, and I'm here to guide you through the daily activities, events, and the ins and outs of what occurs on the street. So sit back, relax, enjoy your cup of coffee, purchase one with some Hong Kong, and enjoy a word from the metaverse. Rosa Shaw here, speaking to you from a small cafe adjacent to the famous Black Sun Bar, giving you the latest on what is happening on the street and what is affecting our world here in the metaverse, to talk about some very current events that are happening. In particular, the next three episodes are going to be talking, we're going to talk about Peter Thiel and his ties to the Trump administration and basically Big Brother and the usage of technology to track people. This episode, we're going to talk about Facebook and Mark Zuckerberg's manifesto and its possible implications on the global world, if you will. And finally, basic income to cap this little topical trilogy, if you will. Before we begin into our topic of this episode, Facebook, the news. So in the news, I found this very interesting story about Vietnam and food. Since food is, you know, one of the four essentials of life. It's food, shelter, safety, and then, like, transportation, if you will. I mean, those four things, and I guess you can probably throw the fifth one in there, clothing, if you will, but actually clothing, kind of, strangely enough, goes kind of very low depending on where you are geographically, if it fits in there or not. But those are kind of the five basic or even four basic essentials of life, if you will. If you have these things covered, you're doing all right. You might not be doing exceptional or good or where you want to be in life, but if you have those kind of basic essentials covered, you're doing far better than, say, people that are without these things or don't have all these things covered. The stress levels in your life very much are determined and are centered around these five essential basics of living. But anyways, this is from Low Tech Magazine, and it's discussing Vietnam's low-tech food system takes and advantages of decay. It's basically centered around the concept of how the Vietnamese people handle their food system, which is very different from the globalization that's happening around other various parts of the world. In particular, their usage of fermentation. So I'm going to read some of this article. And it's by... Well, the picture is by Maxine Gilbert, but I'm not seeing who the author is here. But I have a link in the show notes, so. The food system in the industrialized world is based on mass production, global disruption, and constant refrigeration. It requires many resources and produces a lot of food waste. Aaron Vestigen takes to the street of Hanoi, okay, so he's a writer, where the Vietnamese practice a food culture based largely on fermentation. Although food spoils much faster in a tropical climate, the Vietnamese will often store it without refrigeration and instead take advantage of a controlled decay. Vietnam's decentralized food system has low energy inputs and reduces food waste, giving us a glimpse of an alternative food system that might look like. So this is very interesting because many systems that we currently are using are being re-examined, re-looked at, because it doesn't necessarily work at all. It doesn't work for all people. It's not adequate enough or efficient enough for either the current population or projected population that's going to exist. And fundamentally doing better, you know, whether it be because of, the article opened up about food waste, the environmental impact, the financial impact, just doing things, you know, resource-wise better. And so it's examining a very ancient technique that many different civilizations throughout time had utilized, and Vietnam is currently one of those parts of the world that still utilize this particular type of technique and technology, if you will. So here, in a tropical climate, everything decays faster. Bread gets soft and musty, milk spoils, while the walls get moldy just months after a layer of fresh paint. Food poisoning is a constant concern. The heat and moisture make for an ideal breeding ground for bacteria and fungi. In this environment, you think people would be wary of any food product that smells funny. But in tropical Vietnam, food can be pretty pungent. Take Mai Tom, a purplish paste made of fermented a pre-used shrimp. Cracked open, a jar will result in a distinctive smell, and there's something wrong with it, with hints of marinate within there the whole room. Marinate the whole room. You have chew a stinky fermented tofu, which was so rank that the smallest bit shot up my nose and incinerated my taste buds for an hour. Clears the palate, said the waiter encouragingly. Consider rupmani, which is a sticky rice mix with yeast and left to ferment for several days in a warm place, i.e. the counter. The result is a funky smell, smelly dessert, literally rice left to rot until it turns into a sweet wine pudding. I've actually had this at restaurants, particularly those really frequented by Vietnamese people, so you know it's kind of authentic. It's not like, you know, Americanized, or which is a watered-down version I think you can get in some restaurants, but it's actually very tasty. On the 5th of May of the Lunar Candle, Vietnamese people will eat Rue Nip in the morning to celebrate inner parasite killing day. Bonus, day drunk by the time you arrive at work. You shouldn't forget that Vietnam's world-famous fish sauce, Nguyen Minh, made from diluted fermented fish, a flavor that many people around the world continue to find totally intolerable. In Vietnam, putrefaction is accepted as part of life, even encouraged, but fermentation in Vietnam isn't just an odd quirk in tropical diet. To understand why fermentation is so integral to Vietnamese culture, you have to consider how it is embedded within the people's livelihoods. Local agricultural systems, food safety practices, and a culture obsessed with gastronomy where food is seen as a social glue. And when you bring it together, all three different puzzle pieces, an enchanted picture emerges, one in which fermentation can be fundamentally a component of a sustainable food system. Unlike many high-tech proposals like smart food recycling apps, highly efficient local logistics systems, and food packaging innovations, fermentation is both low-tech and democratic. Anyone can do it. What's more, it has low-energy inputs, bringing people together and hygienic and healthy, and can reduce food waste. So rotting food can be safe and healthy. At the entrance of a market in Hanoi, a woman with a luche stands and tells us that making a sour vegetable is easy. You just add salt to some cabbage and let it sit for a couple of days. As we talk, several customers come by, eager to scoop some rind and cabbage into a plastic bag. Worried that they were discouraging her customers, she shoots us away. She isn't lacking businesses. Is fermentation so effortless? The short answer is yes. Many recipes will call for two things, water and salt, and about a 1 to 5 ratio, 2% of salt to food. You can create an environment undesirable for all that bad bacteria, encourage all the good ones. Sauerkraut, kishi, food sauce, sriracha, and kosher dill pickles are all made according to this principle. Yet other types of fermentation are a bit more complicated. They can call for sugar, i.e. wild fermented alcohol, like the Ethiopian honey wine, yeast starters, moist wines and beers, special fungi, bacteria, salt, or sugar. Yet others are simpler to make. Cooking vinegar, just let the bottle of bad wine sit for a couple of days. And to make sourdough, just mix water and flour and leave it in your on your counter. All in all, fermentation is a controlled decay. You must import ingredients in time. This can sound like a bit too much, too fast. Take the woman I met at the entrance of the market. Her dancha, while in a great demand, looks like wilted cabbage slappy floating in a murky brine. Some bubbles are forming the edges of the plastic container. For the trained eye, a sign of active fermentation process, but for the uninitiated, an alarm bell. There's no use beating about the bush. The dancha is, in fact, rotting in a very similar way that peat swamp is constantly rotting, belching large doses of methane in the world. What has happened is an aerobic fermentation has wow, significant amounts of oxygen. Goes on about that. So let's kind of get into the diverse system here. In the same market, we talked to a vegetable vendor. Real estate in the neighborhood is getting more expensive. Rents are going up. She's having a hard time making ends meet. On her street, many elderly have sold their farmland, which they used to grow vegetables and decorative flowers, and now, unemployed, they spend their time selling homemade fermented vegetables out of their front door. In the same neighborhood, we met Tuna, an elderly woman growing vegetables in the banks of a drain pond. She rarely goes to market. She can grow much of her own food in this little patch. We ask her if she ever fermented her vegetables. Of course, but she doesn't sell them.
than just for herself and her family. So after several months of studying Hanoi's food system and the people who made their living off of it, Vani, my Vietnamese collaborator, and I started to see some patterns. In Western countries, the food system is shaped a little bit like an hourglass. Industrial farms send their food to a supplier who then engages with a handful of supermarket companies who then sell to their consumers. In Vietnam, on the other hand, it looks more like an integrated web, a wholesale night markets, mobile street vendors, covered markets, food baskets organized by office workers with family connections to farms, guerrilla gardening on vacant lots, food is grown, sold, and bought all over the place, and supermarkets are just small, a bit growing, a node in the complex latest works. Most people still get food at the market, but many also source their food from family connections. In Vietnam, many people have had one problem, but when you ask if it's a bit more of a question, it turns out that they have had half a dozen other jobs for extra income. There's a general hustle, and everyone's a bit more of an entrepreneur, and taking with Tom for several hours, we learn that she has, throughout her long life, fish, grown vegetables, corn and fruit, trees, sold rice noodles, bread, ice cream, rose, and silkworms. Now, age 68, she grows decorative peach trees and grows vegetables when she can. With an economy just decades shy of highly regulated communist regime where the only food you could grow was through rations and from the memory of famine still fresh in people's minds, this is highly understandable. With a finger in every pot, you can just about manage to survive. These two factors and a highly distributed food system and diverse livelihoods make for a fertile environment for fermentation practices with easy access to wholesale produce. Many can turn to a small-scale fermentation to complement their income, or in the case of Tim, to spend less on food at the market. So basically everyone is just, you know, they're growing their own stuff. They're selling it to their neighbors. They're selling it at wholesale places. It's very localized. Everything is within a certain small ecosystem. You're not trucking things in, and you're not trucking things out. I wouldn't say it's necessarily a closed loop. I imagine that there's still some of that going to some extent of trucking in and out, but not to the extent that it is, as the author spoke about, in the Western world. And this is something that people are looking at when they're talking about vertical farms, where you can actually start growing in... imagine like the New York, the Empire State Building is changed into a vertical farm where you're literally farming within that big skyscraper, and the produce that is in the vegetables and all that's coming out of there is distributed throughout the city of New York. Instead of farmlands trucking stuff in, it's centered around these little farm hubs that are spread out and contained within the city. And you have to think of the gas is not being spilled, the trucking that's not being utilized, the distributed nature, how everything's very fresh right there in the place. You could probably, they're looking to it, but I'm not sure if it's going to be very effective or very humane or efficient. I'm looking at studies are doing for farm animals, probably small ones, mostly like either pigs possibly, or most likely like chickens and rabbits and things of that nature, small bird-like animals. Well, rabbits aren't birds, as far as meat produce, because even though they're doing lab-grown meat for cows and things of that nature, we're still quite a bit, I would say, about a decade off for that to be like in the marketplace at a mass level, if you will. So these are these alternative looks to for resource efficiency way of distributing food. And studying how the Vietnamese people do this in the use of fermentation, they utilize, you know, you're not using electricity to store your food because you're not refrigerating stuff, is a great examination. Not only that, but there's, I know here in the States, there's a big movement in reevaluating a sale-by date usage, how grocery stores are more interested in how the fruit looks like or the vegetable looks like versus whether or not it's actually spoiled or not. The sell-by date is a suggestion. It's more like what it looks like versus what when you bring it home, whether or not you should be tossing something out. So it's a totally interesting examination. It's a very detailed article. I encourage you, if you're interested in this, looking at this, but just the whole localization and the fact that everyone has a piece of the pie, everyone's doing something, everyone has a hustle, everyone has a business. It's very entrepreneurial. It also shows that, you know, localized economies can effectively, efficiently work. I imagine that they're using a pretty much a cash-based system, but imagine if cryptocurrencies get involved. Imagine if
different forms of economic means goes. I wonder if there's like, a very strong bartering system or trade type of system of skill sets, if you will. This person, you provide them with X amount of food and they, fix your roof or things of that nature. So there's that. Pirate site with no traffic attracts 49 million, mainly bogus DMCA notice. This is from of Torrent Freak by Andy. It's likely you never heard of MP3 Toys XYZ, says the site has very little traffic. However, thanks to a bungling anti-privacy outfit, this site is now the second most complained about pirate site on the internet, with Google receiving more than 49 million notices in just over 6 months. As reporting these pages on many occasions, Google's transparency report is a goldmine for anyone prepared to invest time trawling into the archives. The report is a complete record of every DMCA notice Google receives for its search functions and currently lists more than 2 billion URL takedowns spread over a million websites. Of course, most of these websites will remain faceless since there's far too many to research. That said, the really big offenders are conveniently placed at the top of the list by Google. And so there's Foreshare.com, RapidGator.net is third, UploadersNet.4, and MP3Toys .xyz is 2, and the list of 10 here. As you can see, the four shared file hosting sites in at the top of the list. This isn't a big surprise since the site has been going for years, attracting massive traffic and stores countless millions of files. There are a number of other familiar names too, but what is the site in the second place is MP3Toys XYZ has seriously impressive 49.5 million takedown requests logged against it. We never even heard of it. Checking the site out, MP3Toys is clearly a pirate platform that allows users to download and stream unlicensed MP3s from thousands of artists. There are hundreds of these kinds of sites around, probably pulling content from YouTube and other web sources. But there's a problem. According to Google, MP3Toys XYZ, which also uses a .tech extension, has been appearing in its database since June 30th of 2016. During this short time, Google has received requests to remove 49.5 million URLs from its index. That's about 1.6 million URLs for each of the 31 weeks MP3Toys has been online. No site in history has ever achieved those numbers. It's completely unprecedented. So MP3Toys must be huge, right? Not exactly. According to Alexa, the site's XYZ domain is ranked the 25th millionth most popular online, which is .tech domain is currently ranked 321,000K after being introduced in January 2017. In loose terms, this site has no significant traffic yet, will soon be the most trafficked, most infringed site on the whole net internet. How can this be? Well, this is all down to anti-piracy company making things up and MP3 going along with its charade. As seen on the image below, along with such outfits as BPI and Burn, anti-piracy outfit APDIF do Brazil has an unusual fascination with MP3Toys. In fact, it sent the vast majority of the notices received by Google. However, while some of these notices are undoubtedly correct, it appears a huge number are absolutely bogus. Instead of scanning the site and sending an accurate takedown notice to Google, APDIF tries to guess the URLs where MP3Toys stores its content, and sample list is shown below. The problem here is that the real terms, none of these URLs exist until they've been requested. However, APDIF's guests are entertaining by the site, which creates a random page of music for every search. The content on these auto-generated pages cycles, but never relates to the search being put in. As shown below, even Torrent Freak's Greatest Hits Volume 77 is a winner. So in summary, APDIF makes up its own URLs, MP3Toys randomly generates a page of music that has nothing to do with the URL input, and ATDIF logs it in as an infringement of the client's rights and sends a complaint to Google. Then, putting the icing on an already confused cake, Google removes every URL from its search results, even though it appears they were never in them in the first place. And that's how the site with virtually no traffic receives more DMC complaints than the Pirate Bay. Unbelievable. I'm not sure what the purpose of this type of thing is going on, if these two are cahoots to, I don't know, make some kind of greater complaint against either Google or piracy in general, but that is just highly freaking suspicious. Famed hacker Kevin Mitchell shows you how to go invisible online. The art of invisibility, the world's most famous hacker, teaches you how to be safe in the age of Big Brother and Big Data. It's his new book. If you're like me, one of the first things you do this morning is check your email. And if you're like me, you're also wondering who else has read your email. That's not a paranoid concern.
If you use a web-based email service such as Gmail or Outlook 365, the answer is kind of obvious and frightening. This article is on Wired. It's by Kevin Mitchin himself. Even if you delete an email, the moment you read it on the computer or your mobile phone, that doesn't necessarily erase the content. There's still a copy of it somewhere. Webmail is cloud-based, so in order to be able to access from any device, anywhere, anytime, they have to be redundant copies. If you use Gmail, for example, a copy of every email sent and received through your Gmail account is retained on various servers worldwide at Google. This is also true of your email system provided by Yahoo, Apple, AT&T, and Comcast, and Microsoft. So he just goes down and breaks down the things that you can do. He has a new book coming out. I like Kevin mentioned, he makes his material very easily understandable to the common person. I highly recommend checking out his book. He talks about encryptions and breaks things down very easily for you. Pixar offers free online lessons in storing via Khan Academy by Daryl Etchertin at TechCrunch. There are fewer organizations in the world that can claim more expertise when it comes to storytelling than Pixar. The Disney-owned animation studio is known to its ability to constantly create world-class movies with gripping narratives alongside stunning visuals. Now Pixar is helping others learn the secret of great storytelling for free in a partnership with online educator Khan Academy. The two have teamed up to create Pixar in a Box. In this third installment of the series, lessons are sourced from Pixar directors and story artists, including Inside and Out and Up director Peter Docter, Brave director Mark Anders, Inside Out story artist Doreen Shi, and Ratatouille animator Sanjeev Patel. The first lesson is available now and provide an introduction to storytelling as well as help you hone your initial creation of things like setting and character. The lessons inside both videos and activities for students to complete provides a general basis on which to build. The next installment will focus on character creation specifically, and other segments will address storyboarding, emotional appeal, and more, with releases happening throughout 2017. Pixar's previous Khan Academy courses include topics like virtual cameras, effects, and animation, but this is the first to focus on the less technical aspect of movie creation. Expect Pixar will offer me a job upon the completion of this course, and then I'll win my Oscar. So I think this is very good, particularly considering that Khan Academy is something that's so widely utilized by, I would say, children between the ages of 8 and 18. While there's a lot of young adults as well, just generally anyone using it, it's a great way to engage, you know, young people's imaginations and either channel this into the arts or other aspects of their life, if you will. And then here's a link to an article. I'm not going to get too into it, but it's by Dale Burnham. It's called 4chan, The Skeleton Key to the Rise of Trump. Trump's young supporters know he's an incompetent joke. In fact, that's why they support him. And then he breaks down just how 4chan and that particular culture helped propel Trump into office. It's broken down to these parts like, one, born from something awful. Around 2005 or so, a strange thing showed up in my old webcomics referral logs. This new site I didn't understand. It was a bulletin board, but its system of navigation was opaque. Counterintuitively, you can hit a reply to read a thread. Moreover, the content was bizarre and nonsense. The site, if you hadn't guessed it, was 4chan.org. And then he goes on about how the origins of 4chan. Two, Anon steps out to fight Lord Inzuna. He talks about the Scientology fights. What's the other points here? Three, New Horizons. After what happened after the Scientology fight. Just pretty much the origin story of 4chan, Gamergate, Anon defends his safe spaces, and just how over a decade, if you will, Trump the loser who won, how 4chan, this kind of type of culture, led to the rise of Trump in America. Six, Trump the Frog. It's just a wonderful breakdown. I highly recommend it. It's a very easy read. Very easily sourced, widely shared. I would encourage it, honestly, if you want to have an understanding of the culture and breakdown. I might, in fact, do a little bit more about this, particularly about the history of 4chan. Talk about that particular website, because 4chan, Reddit,
and a few others have had a significant impact on the development of the internet in and of itself, in the culture, if you will. So, but that is it for the news. On to the main topic, which is about Facebook, and in particular about Mark Zuckerberg's recently released manifesto. So Mark Zuckerberg released a manifesto that he thinks will help save the world. I'm going to read the manifesto, and then we're going to talk about some of the pushback of it. This is the unredacted. There was a little bit of a change, which I'll talk about at the end of the manifesto. So here it is. Building global community. To our community. On our journey to connect the world, we often discuss products we are building and updates on our business. Today, I want to focus on the most important question of all. Are we building the world we all want? History is the story of how we learn to come together in ever greater numbers, from tribes to cities to nations. At each step, we built social infrastructures like communities, media, and government to empower us to achieve things we couldn't on our own. Today, we are close to taking our next step. Our greatest opportunities are now global, like spreading prosperity and freedom, promoting peace and understanding, lifting people out of poverty, and accelerating science. Our greatest challenge also need global responses, like ending terrorism, fighting climate change, and preventing pandemics. Progress now requires humanity coming together not just as cities or nations, but also as a global community. This is especially important right now. Facebook stands for bringing us closer together and building a global community. When we began, this idea was not controversial. Each year, the world got more connected, and this was seen as a positive trend. Yet now, across the world, there are people left behind by globalization and movements for withdrawing from global connection. There are questions about whether we can make a global community that works for everyone, and whether the path ahead is to connect more or reverse course. This is a time when many of us around the world are reflecting how we can have the most positive impact. I'm reminded of one of my favorite sayings about technology. We always overestimate what we can do in 2 years, and we underestimate what we can do in 10 years. We may not have the power to create the world we want immediately, but we can all start working on the long term today. In times like these, the most important thing we at Facebook can do is develop the social infrastructure to give people the power to build a global community that works for all of us. For the past decade, Facebook has focused on connecting friends and family. With that foundation, our next focus will be developing the social infrastructure for community, for supporting us, for keeping us safe, for informing us, for civic engagement, and for inclusion of all. Bringing us all together as a global community is a project bigger than any one organization or company, but Facebook can help contribute to answer these 5 important questions. How do we help people build supportive communities that strengthen traditional institutions in a world where membership in these institutions is declining? How do we help people build a safe community that prevents harm, helps during crisis, and rebuilds afterwards in a world where anyone across the world can affect us? How do we help people build an informed community that exposes us to new ideas and builds common understanding in a world where every person has a voice? How do we help build a civically engaging community in a world where participation in voting sometimes including less than half our population? How do we help build an inclusive community that reflects our collective values and common humanity from local to global levels, spanning cultures, nations, and regions in a world with a few examples of global communities? My hope is that more of us will commit our energy to building the long-term social infrastructure to bring in humanity together. The answer to these questions won't all come from Facebook, but I believe we can play a role. Our job at Facebook is to help people make the greatest positive impact while mitigating areas where technology and social media can contribute to divisive and isolation. Facebook is a work in progress, and we are dedicated to learning and improving. We take our responsibility seriously, and today I want to talk about how we can plan to do our part to build this global community. Supportive communities. Building a global community that works for everyone starts with the millions of smaller communities and intimate social structures we turn to for our personal, emotional, and spiritual needs. Whether churches, sports teams, unions, or other local groups that all share important roles as social infrastructures for our communities. They provide us all with a sense of purpose and hope, moral validations that we are needed and part of this something bigger than ourselves. Comfort that we are not alone and the community is looking out for us. Mentorships, guidance, and personal development. A safety net, values, cultural norms, and accountability. Social gatherings, rituals, and a way to meet new people and a way to pass time. In our society, we have personal relationships with friends and families,
family, and then we have institutional relationships with the governments that set the rules. A healthy society also has many layers of communities between us and government that take care of our needs. When we refer to our social fabric, we usually mean the many mediating groups that bring us together and reinforce our values. However, there's been a striking decline in important social infrastructure of local communities for the past few decades. Since the 1970s, membership in some local groups has declined by as far as one quarter, cutting across all segments of the population. The decline raises deeper questions alongside surveys showing larger percentage of our population lack a sense of hope for the future. It's possible many are challenges at least as much social as they are economic, related to the lack of community and connection to something greater than ourselves. As a pastor told me, people feel unsettled. A lot of what's settling in the past doesn't exist anymore. Online communities are a bright spot, and we can strengthen existing physical communities by helping people come together online as well as offline. In the same way connecting with friends online strengthens real relationships, developing the infrastructure will strengthen these communities as well, enabling complete new ones to form. A woman named Christina was diagnosed with a rare disorder called Erythromelalgia bullosa, and now she's a member of a group that connects 2,400 people around the world, so none of them have to suffer alone. A man named Matt was raising his two sons by himself and started the Black Fathers Group to help men share advice and encouragement as they raise their families. In San Diego, more than 4,000 military family members are part of a group that helps them make friends with other spouses. These communities don't just interact online, they hold get-togethers, organize dinners, and support each other in daily lives. We have recently found that more than 100 million people on Facebook are members of what we call very meaningful groups. These are groups that upon joining quickly become the most important part of our social network experience and an important part of our physical support structure. For example, many new parents tell us that joining a parent group after having a child fits this purpose. There's a real opportunity to connect more of us with groups that will be meaningful social infrastructure in our lives. More than 1 billion people are active members of Facebook groups, but most don't seek our groups on their own. Friends send invites or Facebook suggests them. If we can improve our suggestions and help connect 1 billion people with meaningful communities, that can strengthen our social fabric. Going forward, we will measure Facebook's progress with groups based on meaningful groups, not groups overall. This will require not only helpful people connecting with existing meaningful groups, but also enabling community leaders to create more meaningful groups for people to connect with. The most successful physical communities have engaged leaders, and we've seen the same with online groups as well. In Berlin, a man named Manis Burka runs a group where he personally helps refugees find homes and jobs. Today's Facebook tools for group admins are relatively simple. We can plan to build more tools to empower community leaders like Morris to run and grow their group the way they like, similar to what we've done with Pages. Most communities are made from many sub-communities, and this is another clear area for developing new tools. A school, for example, is not a single community, but many smaller groups among its classes, dorms, and student groups. Just as the social fabric of society is made up of many communities, each community is made up of many groups or personal connections. We plan to expand the groups to support sub-communities. We can look at many activities through the lens of building community. Watching a video of our favorite sports team or TV show, reading our favorite newspaper, or playing our favorite game are not just entertainment or information, but a shared experience and opportunity to bring together people who care about the same things. We can design these experiences not for passive consumption, but for strengthening social connection. Our goal is to strengthen existing communities by helping us come together online as well as offline, as well as enabling us to form complete new communities transcending physical location. When we can do this beyond connecting online, we reinforce our physical communities by bringing us together in person to support each other. A healthy society needs these communities to support our personal, emotional, and spiritual needs. In a world where the physical social infrastructure has been declining, we have a real opportunity to help strengthen these communities in the social fabric of our society. Safe community. As we build a global community, there's a moment of truth. Our success isn't just based on whether we can capture videos and share them with friends. It's about whether we build in a community to help us keep that helps us keep us safe, that prevents harm, helps during crisis, and rebuilds afterwards. Today, threats are increasingly global, but the infrastructure to protect us is not. Problems like terrorism, natural disasters, disease, refugee crisis, and climate change need coordinated responses from a worldwide vantage point. No nation can solve them alone. A virus in one nation can quickly spread to others. A conflict in one country can create a refugee crisis across continents. Pollution in one place can affect the environment around the world. Humanity's current systems are inefficient to address these issues. Many dedicated people join global nonprofit organizations to help, but the market often fails to find or incentivize building the necessary infrastructure.
I have long expected more organizations and startups to build healthy and safety tools using technology, and I have been surprised by how little or what must be built even built has it even been attempted. This is a real opportunity to build global safety infrastructures, and I objected Facebook to invest more and more resources into serving this need. For some of these problems, the Facebook community is a unique position to help prevent harm, assist during crisis, or come together to rebuild afterwards. This is because of the amount of communication across our network, our ability to quickly reach people worldwide in an emergency, and the vast scale of people's intrinsic goodness aggregated across our community. To prevent harm, we can build social infrastructures to help our community identify problems before they happen. When someone's thinking of committing suicide or hurting themselves, we built infrastructures to give the friends and community tools that can save their lives. When a child goes missing, we built infrastructures to show Amber Alerts, and multiple children have been rescued without harm. And we've built infrastructures to work with public safety organizations around the world when we become aware of these issues. Going forward, there's even more cases where our community should be able to identify risk related to mental health, disease, or crime. To help during a crisis, we have built infrastructures like safety checks so we can let all our friends know we're safe and check on our friends who might be affected by an attack or a natural disaster. Safety Check has been active almost 500 times in 2 years and already notified people that their families and friends are safe more than a billion times. When there's a disaster, governments often call us to make sure Safety Check has been activated in their countries, but there's more to build. We recently added tools to find and offer shelter, food, and other resources during emergencies. Over time, our community should be able to help during wars and ongoing issues that are not limited to a single event. To rebuild after a crisis, we built the world's largest social infrastructure for collective action. A few years ago, after an earthquake in Nepal, the Facebook community raised $15 million to help people recover and rebuild, which was the largest crowdfunded relief effort in history. We saw a similar effort after the shooting at the Pulse nightclub in Orlando, when people across the country organized blood donations to help victims that they had never met. Similarly, we built tools so millions of people could commit to becoming organ donors to save others after accidents, and registry reported larger boosts in signups than ever before. Looking ahead, one of our greatest opportunities to keep people safe is building artificial intelligence to understand more quickly and accurately what is happening across our community. There are billions of posts and comments and messages across our services each day, and since it's impossible to review all of them, we review content once it's reported to us. There have been terrible tragic events like suicide, some live stream that perhaps could have been prevented if someone had realized what was happening and reported them sooner. There are cases of bullying and harassment every day that our team must be alerted to before we can help out. These stories show us we must find a way to do more. Artificial intelligence can help provide a better approach. We are researching systems that can look at a photo and video to flag content on our team should review. This is very early in development, but we can start to have it looked at some content, and it already generates about one-third of all reports to the team that review content for our community. It will take many years to fully develop these systems. Right now, we are starting to explore ways to use AI to tell the difference between news stories about terrorism and actual terrorist propaganda so we can quickly remove anyone trying to use our services to recruit for terrorist organizations. This is technically difficult as it requires building an AI that can read and understand news, but we need to work on this to help fight terrorism worldwide. As we assess keeping our community safe, it's important to emphasize that part of keeping people safe is protecting individual security and liberty. We are strong advocates of encryption and have built it into the largest messaging platform in the world, WhatsApp and Messenger. Keeping our community safe does not require compromising privacy, since building end-to-end encryption into WhatsApp, we have reduced spam and malicious content by more than 75%. The path forward is to recognize that a global community needs social infrastructure to keep us safe from threats around the world, and that our community is uniquely positioned to prevent disasters, help during crisis, and rebuild afterwards. Keeping the global community safe is an important part of our mission and an important part of how we'll measure our progress going forward. Informed community. The purpose of any community is to bring people together to do things we can do on our own. To do this, we need ways to share new ideas and share enough common understanding to actually work together. Giving everyone a voice has historically been a very positive force for public discourse because it increases the diversity of ideas shared. But the past year has also shown it may fragment our shared sense of reality. It is our responsibility to amplify the good effects and mitigate the bad, to continue increasing diversity while strengthening our common understanding so our community can create the greatest positive impact on the world. The two most discussed concerns the past year was about diversity of viewpoints we see, filter bubbles, and the accuracy of information, fake news.
I worry about these, and we have studied them extensively, but I also worry that there are more powerful effects we must mitigate around sensationalism and polarization leading to a loss of common understanding. Social media already provides more diverse viewpoints than the traditional media ever has. Even if most of our friends are like us, we all know people with different interests, beliefs, and backgrounds, who expose us to different perspectives. Compared with getting our news from the same two or three TV networks or reading the same newspapers with their constituent editorial views, our networks on Facebook show us more diverse content. But our goal must help people see a more complete picture, not just alternative perspectives. We must be careful in how we do this. Research shows that some of the most obvious ideas, like showing people an article from the opposite perspective, actually deepens polarization by framing other perspectives as foreign. A more effective approach is to show a range of perspectives, let people see where their views are on a spectrum, and come to a conclusion on what they think is right. Over time, our community will identify which sources provide a complete range of perspectives so that the content will naturally surface more. Accuracy of information is very important. We know there's misinformation and even outright hoax content on Facebook, and we take this very seriously. We may progress fighting hoaxes the way we fight spam, but we have more work to do. We are proceeding carefully because this is not always a clear line between hoax, satire, and opinion. In a free society, it's important that people have the power to share their opinion, even if others think they're wrong. Our approach will focus less on banning misinformation and more on surfacing additional perspectives and information, including that fact-checkers dispute an item's accuracy. While we have more work to do on information diversity and misinformation, I even more focus on the impact of sensationalism and polarization and the idea of building common understanding. Social media is a short-form medium where resonating messages get amplified many times. This rewards simplicity and discourages nuance. At its best, this focused message and exposes people to different ideas. At its worst, it oversimplifies important topics and pushes us towards extremes. Polarization exists in all areas of discourse, not just social media. It occurs in all groups and communities, including companies, classrooms, and juries, and is usually unrelated to politics. In the tech community, for example, discussions around AI have been oversimplified to existential fear-mongering. The harm is that sensationalism moves people away from balanced, nuanced opinions towards polarized extremes. If this continues and we lose common understanding, then even if we eliminate all misinformation, people can't just emphasize different sets of facts to fit their polarized opinions. That's why I'm so worried about sensationalism in media. Fortunately, there are clear steps we can take to correct this effect. For example, we notice some people share stories based on sensational headlines without ever reading the story. In general, if people become less likely to share a story after reading it, that's a good sign that headlines was sensational. If you're more likely to share a copy after reading it, then that's often a sign of good in-depth content. We recently started reducing sensationalism in news feeds by taking this into account for pieces of content, and going forward, signals like this will identify sensational publishers as well. There are many steps like this we have taken and we will keep taking to reduce sensationalism and help build a more informed community. Research suggests the best solution for improving discourse may come from getting to know each other as whole people instead of just opinions. Sometimes Facebook may be uniquely suited to do. If we connect people about what we have in common, sports teams, TV shows, interests, it's easier to have a dialogue about what we disagree on. When we do this well, we give billions of people the ability to share a new perspective while mitigating the unwanted effects that come with any new medium. A strong news industry is also critical to building an informed community. Giving people a voice is not enough without having people dedicated to uncovering new information and analyzing it. There is more we must do to support the news industry to make sure this vital social function is sustainable, forming growing local news, developing formats best suited to mobile devices, to improving the range of business models news organizations rely on. Connecting everyone to the internet is also necessary for building an informed community. For the majority of people around the world, debate is not about the quality of public discourse, but whether they have access to basic information they need at all, often related to health, education, and jobs. Finally, I want to emphasize that the vast majority of the conversations on Facebook are social, not ideological. There's friends sharing jokes and families staying in touch across cities. There are people finding groups, whether they're new parents raising kids or newly diagnosed patients suffering from a disease together. Sometimes it's for joy, coming together around religion or sports, and sometimes it's for survival, like refugees communicating to find shelter. Whether your situation when you enter our community or commitment is to continue improving our tools to give you the power to share your experience. By increasing the diversity of our ideas and strengthening our common understanding, our community can have the greatest positive impact on the world. A civically engaged community. Our society will reflect our collective values only if we engage in the civic process and participate in self-governance. There are two distinctive types of social infrastructure that must be built. The first encourages engagement in existing political process, voting, engaging with issues and representatives, speaking out, and sometimes organizing. Only through dramatically greater engagement can we ensure these political processes reflect our values. The second is establishing a new process for citizens worldwide to participate in collective decision-making. Our world is more connected than ever, and we face global problems that span national boundaries. As the largest global community, Facebook can explore examples of how community governments might work at scale. A starting point for the civic engagement in the existing political process is to support voting across in the world. It is striking that only about half of Americans eligible to vote participate in elections. This is low compared to other countries, but democracy is receding in many countries, and there is a large opportunity across the world to encourage civic participation. In the United States election last year, we helped more than 2 million people register to vote and then go vote. This is among the largest voter turnout efforts in history and larger than those of both major parties combined. In every election around the world, we keep improving our tools to help more people register and vote, and we hope that eventually enable hundreds of millions of more people to vote in elections than do today in every democratic country around the world. Local civic engagement is a big opportunity as well as national. Today, most of us do not even know who our local representatives are, but many policies impact our lives are local, and this is where our participation has the greatest influence. Research suggests reading local news is directly correlated with local civic engagement. This shows how building an informed community, supportive local communities, and a civil engaged community are all related. Beyond voting, the greatest opportunity is to help people stay engaged with the issues that matter to them every day, not just every few years at the ballot box. We can help establish direct dialogue and accountability between people and our elected leaders. In India, Prime Minister Modi has asked his ministers to share their meetings and information on Facebook so they can hear direct feedback from citizens. In Kenya, whole villages are in WhatsApp groups together, including the representatives. In recent campaigns around the world, from India and in Indonesia across Europe to the United States, we've seen the candidates with the largest and most engaged following on Facebook usually wins. Just as TV became the primary media for civic communication in the 1960s, social media is becoming this in the 21st century. This creates an opportunity for us to connect with our representatives at all levels. In the last few months, we have already helped our community double the number of connections between people and our representatives by making it easier to connect with our representatives in one click. When we connect, we can engage directly in the communities and messages. For example, in Iceland, it's common to tag politicians in group discussions so they can take community issues to parliament. Sometimes people must speak out and demonstrate for what they believe in is right, from Tiara Square to the Tea Party, our community organizations, these demonstrations using our infrastructure for events and groups. On a daily basis, people use their voices to share their views in ways that can spread around the world and grow into movements. The Women's March is an example of this, where a grandmother with an internet connection wrote a post that led her friends to start a Facebook event that eventually turned into millions of people marching in cities around the world. Giving people a voice is the principle our community has been committed to since we began. As we look ahead to build the social infrastructure for a global community, we will work on building new tools that encourage thoughtful civic engagement, empowering us to use our voices, will only become more important. Inclusive community. Building an inclusive global community requires establishing a new process for citizens worldwide to participate in community governments. I hope that we can explore examples of how collective decision-making might work at scale. Facebook is not just technology or media, but a community of people. That means we need community standards to reflect our collective values for what should and should not be allowed. In the last year, the complexity of the lives we have seen has outstripped our existence process for governing the community. We saw this in errors in taking down newsworthy videos related to Black Lives Matter and police violence, and in removing the historical terror of war photo from Vietnam. We've seen this misclassified hate speech and political debates in both directions, taking down accounts and content that should be left up and leaving up content that was hateful and should be taken down. Both the number of issues and their cultural importance has increased recently. This has been painful for me because I've often agreed with those criticizing us that we're making mistakes. These mistakes are almost never because we hold ideological positions at odds with the community, but instead are operating our operational scaling issues. Our guiding philosophy for the community standards is try to reflect the cultural norms of a community. When in doubt, we always favor giving people the power to share more. There are a few reasons for the increase in issues we've seen. Cultural norms are shifting, cultures are different around the world, and people are sensitive to different things. First, our community is evolving from its origin connecting us with family and friends to now becoming a source of news and public discourse as well. With this cultural shift, our community standards must adapt to permit more newsworthy and historical content, even if some is objectionable. For example, an extremely violent video of someone dying would have been marked as disturbed and taken down. However, now that we use live to capture the news and we post videos to protest violence, our standards must adapt. Similarly, a photo depicting any child nudity would always have been taken down for good reason, but we now adapted our standards to allow historical important content like the Terror of War photo. These issues reflect a need to update our standards to meet evolving expectations from our community. Second, our community spans many countries and cultures, and norms are different in each region. It's not surprising that Europeans more frequently find fault with taking down images depicting nudity, since some European cultures are more accepted in nudity than, for example, many communities in the Middle East or Asia. With a community of almost 2 billion people, it is less feasible to have a single set of standards to govern the entire community, so we need to evolve towards a system of more local governance. Third, even with a given culture, we have different opinions on what we want to see and what is objectionable. I may be okay with more politically charged speech, but not to see anything sexually suggestive, while you may be okay with nudity, but not want to see offensive speech. Similarly, you may want to share a violent video of protest without worrying that you're going to bother friends who don't want to see it. And just as it's a bad experience to see objectionable content, it's also a terrible experience to be told we can't share something we feel is important. This suggests we need to evolve towards a system of personal control over our experience. Fourth, we're operating at a large scale that even a small percentage of errors causes a large number of bad experiences. We review over 100 million pieces of content every month, and even if our reviewers get 99% of the calls right, there's still millions of errors over time. Any system will always have some mistakes, but I believe we can do better than we are today. I spent a lot of time over the past year reflecting on how we can improve our community governance. Sitting here in California, We're not best positioned to identify cultural norms around the world. Instead, we need a system where we can all contribute to the setting standards. Although the system is not fully developed, I want to share an idea of how this might work. The guiding principles in our community standards should reflect the cultural norms of our community, that each person should see as little objectionable content as possible, and each person should be able to share what they want while being told they cannot share something as little as possible. The approach is to combine creating a large-scale democratic process to determine standards with AI to help enforce them. The idea is to give everyone in the community options for how they would like to set the content policy for themselves. Where is your line on nudity, on violence, on graphic content, on profanity? What you decide will be your personal settings. We will periodically ask you these questions to increase participation, and so you don't need to dig around to find them. For those who don't make a decision, the default will be whatever the majority of the people in your region select, like a referendum. Of course, you'll always be free to update your personal settings anytime. With a broader range of controls, content will only be taken down if it's more objectionable than the most permissive options allowed. Within that range, content should simply not be shown to anyone whose personal controls suggest they would not want to see it, or at least they should see a warning sign. Although we still block content based on standards and local laws, our hope is that a system of personal controls and democratic referenda should minimize restrictions on what we can share. It's worth noting that major advances in AI are required to understand text, photos, and videos to judge whether they can contain hate speech, graphic violence, sexual explicit content, and more. At our current pace of research, we hope to begin handling some of these cases in 2017, but others will not be possible for many years. Overall, it's important that the governance of our community scales with the complexity and demands of its people. We are committed to always doing better, even that involves building a worldwide voting system to give you more voice and control. Our hope is that this model provides an example of how collective decision-making may work in other aspects of global community. This is an important time in development in our global community, and it is a time when many of us around the world are reflecting on how we can have the most positive impact. History has many moments like today, and we've made our greatest leap from tribes to cities to nations. We've always had to build social infrastructures like communities, media, and governance for us to thrive at each of the next level. At each step, we learn how to come together to solve our challenges and accomplish greater things than we could alone. We have done it before, and we will do it again. I'm reminded of President Lincoln's remarks during the American Civil War. We can succeed only by concert. It's not can any of us imagine better, but can we all do better? The dogmas of the quiet past are inadequate to the stormy present. The occasion is piled high with difficulty, and we must rise with the occasion. As our case is new, we must think anew and act anew. There are many of us who stand for bringing people together and connecting the world. I hope we have the focus to take the long view and build a new social infrastructure to create the world we want for generations to come. It's an honor to be on this journey with you. Thank you for being part of this community, and thanks for everything you can do to make the world more open and connected.
Now, Mark Zuckerberg in the past has stated that privacy is something that is dead, and it's not something that Facebook seeks to protect or do. Now, this kind of change, if you will, in position with the WhatsApp encryption and encryption and seeking these communities and addressing the needs of reflecting people's personal choices in the new feed, it seems that he's taken a more softer stance on privacy somewhat, but it remains to be seen. But we will talk about the pushback in the next segment about this manifesto, if you will. So there's been some pushback against Mark Zuckerberg's Facebook manifesto, as there should be, because, you know, just read it. It's quite a lot there. And it's a little sad and very telling, considering that, you know, Mark Zuckerberg and a number of the heads of the various technology companies now, many of them are older millennials, younger Gen Xers, if you will, and even some younger millennials, if you will, the head of Snapchat comes to mind. And these guys were heavily influenced by the cypherpunk movement, by the early 90s hackers and developers and technology guys, the gurus, if you will. And they've taken some of their ideas and, I don't want to say capitalizing them. Some of it is capitalized in a negative sense. But have taken it and just gone so far from the basic tenets of the cypherpunk movement, particularly if we talk about Uber and the concept of the sharing economy, if you will. If we talk about communication, the distributed nature of information, and how, depending on your viewpoint, it's like a race, if you will, on who's going to be that Uber technology company that takes over everything that you see in like every cyberpunk book and movie, or every single dystopian type of novel that's come out since probably pretty much the 60s. There's always that one corporation that owns and takes over everything. And it's just kind of sad because there was such promise with Facebook, but when you look at the origin of Facebook, it was very obvious that the sole purpose was just a data collection site and to sell ads and to do all that. And there was no significant, as far as ethical or ethos, about that. There was no qualms of that. That was the sole purpose of Facebook. But there was a bit of a kernel of promise, if you think about just a way of connecting people to one another through vast distances in an open and sharing manner, if you will, letting people know about your day, your thoughts, your feelings. Particularly the early years of Facebook is very much like that, when it was primarily, you know, college kids were using it, but just as it was first expanding and open, all the various notes that people were doing. Now this ecosystem is almost like a closed loop. Was doing what AOL tried initially to do, be like a closed loop ecosystem where Yes, you're sharing and interacting with your family and friends, but you also have all these advertisements. You have businesses that are on there. You can sell ads. You can actually sell goods, kind of like a eBay, if you will. Communication as far as like text-based system with the Facebook Messenger. You can do video chat. You can do Facebook Live. It's trying to be all everything and anything in one singular app, even though they have or singular place or site, I should say. Even though they've broken off their apps, I imagine a lot of those apps are going to consolidate together and be like WeChat, because WeChat doesn't break itself off. You don't have WeChat just the Messenger and WeChat Facebook Live. Everything's done within WeChat. And I imagine eventually Facebook is going to collapse back together into one singular app where you do everything within it and you don't ever leave really Facebook, if you will. Which is a problem in itself, because that's what Facebook is trying to present itself with, the whole free internet that it's trying to do with some of these developing countries. And you saw India pushing back against that. But we'll save that for another time. We'll just talk about the pushback to Mark Zuckerberg's manifesto. So let's begin with spilling a little bit of the tea, if you will. This is from Back Channel. It's written by Stephen Levy. Behind the scenes of Mark Zuckerberg's manifesto, humanity's in trouble. Facebook CEO explains how he plans to fix it. So in 1862, Abraham Lincoln addressed Congress. It was a grim time for a country newly immersed in a civil war. He saw an opportunity in strife. Lincoln had only weeks away from signing the Emancipation Proclamation, and to gain support, he was painting his audacious act as an out-of-the-box consequence of the current crisis. Here's what the president of a nation torn asunder said. We can succeed only by concert. It is not, and can't any of us imagine better, but can we all do better? The dogmas of the quiet past are inadequate to the stormy present. The occasion is piled high with difficulty, and we must rise with the occasion. As our case is new, we must think anew and act anew. This history lesson comes courtesy of Mark Zuckerberg, the founder and the CEO of Facebook, who quoted those words of Lincoln's in his 5,700-word post he dropped on his timeline today, citing such a lofty antecedent underlying the gravity of Zuckerberg's message here. He's explicitly constructing no less than a roadmap for a new global social infrastructure. Though he takes pains to say that Facebook wants to be only part of a broader movement to build the social edif, the post represents a significant shift for the company. It marks a broadening of his focus on connecting small groups and families to a more sweeping role in building larger and more meaningful communities on a global scale to fill an increasingly worrisome gap in the social fabric. Last week, as Zuckerberg was writing this mission statement for Facebook's next era, I stopped by the company's Milan Park headquarters to get a preview of his thinking. There, sitting on the couch where he often conducts product reviews and dresses in his standard gray t-shirt and jeans, he spoke about Facebook's responsibility to a world where social connectivity has created many beneficial effects and some not so beneficial. Facebook takes at its core truth about sharing, connecting is a force that will improve the world. Indeed, at the advent of the social media, we all thought that giving somebody a voice would help us all to be heard, and the world would be more open and welcoming place. But in the wake of the contentious election in the U.S. abroad, and with the general sense that the world itself is slipping off the rails, critics are calling out Facebook as a source of destabilizing fake news hoaxes and isolating filter belt bubbles. Some people are even ending friendships over knee-jerk reactions to political differences expressed on the software he created. Zuckerberg himself admits that his company's response, indeed the company itself, is a work in progress. It is not clear as to whether giving people a voice builds common understanding or fragments a shared sense of reality, he says, though clearly every bone in his body lives the former. So this is an interesting take about all this. The thing with the fake news, and I think the label we should get into, is fake news is just the making up of bullshit, if you will, of not just parody where, you know, Bat Boy lives, but taking a bit of kernel of truth and stretching it to the point of non-existence or nonsense, if you will, which prevailed throughout the election cycle. And it was a bunch of kids, these teenagers in Macedonia, that created all these different articles that got shared throughout the world, but most predominantly because it was emphasis on Trump and the U.S. election, throughout the United States through various mediums, through Google and primarily Facebook, but not exclusively so. And
I'm not sure exactly what Facebook's responsibility would have been to stop the sharing of these particular news articles. I mean, the whole purpose of Facebook is to share. And there are certain significant issues with that in and of itself, like, for example, disseminating hateful information or death threats or, you know, child pornography. All, you know, not to go extremely negative, but I'm not positive exactly what Facebook could have done, other than maybe putting a label on it, saying that this story is a false story, and so allow people to share it. But I don't know if that stamp is something that is the responsibility of Facebook. There's a whole lot of infrastructural breakdowns that occurred during the U.S. election cycle between the year of 2015 and now. But I know Facebook's reaction to the fake news stuff wasn't exactly the best response I think that the company could have had. With this post, Zuckerberg has chosen to address these issues by vastly expanding the discussion. Instead of getting bogged down in the specific controversy of fake news, though he does address it in his post, he's placing it in the context of a bigger picture, a global crisis where humanity itself has edged away from commodity and descended to tribalism and finger-pointing. This is our stormy present, as they put it, and Facebook is on it. My personal take on this is this. I think we were always tribalistic. I think we were always finger-pointing. The theme was this prior to the advent of the internet, in particular the advent of social media. The voices that were marginalized, if you will, were in small spaces. They didn't have access or direct access to the New York Times. Even if they were able to write particular stories or thoughts or ideas, it wasn't disseminated all the time. It's just like either the back page or one editorial op-ed, maybe once or twice a year or something like that. It was very, very small. Now, they did create their own newspapers and news stories, but it was disseminated within their own community. Versus, and I'm just talking particularly of the U.S., because I am, you know, an American, so I can only speak upon my community, my culture, if you will. But the larger sense, the larger tribal sense, if you will, or the larger voice, if you will, was considered universal and disseminated all the time. And what it happened with social media is you started seeing, you know, people started connecting. It started with, you know, very early on with boards, when people connected over, you know, whether it be movies, you know, I would say not nonsensical, but like trivial matters, like, you know, Star Wars, Star Trek. The X-Files became a social phenomenon. The whole concept of shipping, if you're not familiar with shipping is when relationships are advocated for a particular, either typically television, but movies or television or books. Mulder and Scully were considered the, you know, first relationship that people wanted to see happen within their television show, and it was called shipping or shippers, relationship shippers. It broke down, and that concept or that genre, if you will, has spread throughout various different forms, from cartoons to movies to, like I said, books, movies, TV shows. Any form of shipping you can think of is occurring in some kind of fandom and fanfic, which has been around for a very long time, I would think, beginning with Star Trek, but has been disseminated throughout the internet. And then you started getting, you know, social conscious stuff where people are talking about gay rights, trans issues, black issues, Hispanic issues, immigration, foreign policy. They started talking about politics and finding people of similar thought and thinking. They're living in, you know, Wichita, Kansas, and they're a homosexual, and they cannot be open because they live in a very extremely conservative area, and to do so would be a threat and danger to them. They would get their ass kicked. They would get stomped. I remember when I went to university in 1998, there was a series of gay bashings that were happening within around my very small liberal arts former women college campus. And, you know, so it was not, if you were even perceived as being gay, you had the risk of having violence being put upon you if you step off a campus. If you were open about it, there was a danger of you being attacked. There was a danger of you being attacked not only by your fellow students, but just by random people that think it was their place or responsibility to exercise you from this world. And so when you're
talking to somebody who has the same similar situation, or maybe they're, you know, in a city like Austin or even Las Vegas. Most people don't realize that Las Vegas has a very strong gay, lesbian, trans community and queer community, and has for a very long time. It's been a very open place when it comes to that, even though there has been issues, and like in any place there's issues with anything, particularly when dealing with marginalized people. You're talking, communicating, and speaking about your life and experiences, and you realize that you're not alone. You're not the only person who has this thought, or has read this book, or read this article. Things that were once, you know, trivial things, like I said, you know, Star Wars, Star Trek, and stuff like that, expanded and expanded, and as those communities began to develop, they went from boards to blogs to news sites to commercial websites to people now developing their own news sites like Salon or Huffington Post or even Drudge Report, all these different things that were no longer controlled by, you know, centralized authorities like certain media companies. I think the most famous scene from The West Wing was when, what was the press secretary's name? So blanking on it. Hold on. CJ, and she like pretty much kicked everyone out of the press except for like 12 reporters or something, or 7 reporters. It was like only keeping these 7 reporters because everyone else is, you know, you're all owned by the same corporations, the same 7 corporations, and it wasn't fair, and it's not good, it's not great for the free press, if you will. And that's what was happening with all sorts of businesses. That's why things got disrupted, because you had things like eBay, Amazon, all these different companies that, because they're able to connect to the internet and because of credit cards, they were able to accept payment forms, and so they were able to sell directly to consumers. Right now, a lot of clothing stores right now are shutting down because of this disruption of online commerce, where people are buying their clothes through Amazon or just online in general, not going into the store. Certain types of clothing stores are ceasing to exist because they weren't able to pivot or cater to different types of markets. And not to get too sidetracked here, but because of that, because of these marginalized voices starting to increasingly gaining access and developing their own access, and because of the internet they're able to be heard, people started having a bit of an uproar, because now they are hearing a viewpoint that has always been expressed, but because of these actual true real life bubbles, these, you know, 7 corporations owning all these different types of news things and radio stations and television stations, and always disseminating only one kind of certain viewpoint, people thought they were being challenged, or perceiving themselves being challenged, instead of saying, oh, this is a voice I've never heard before, I didn't realize, you know, such ideology existed, or such concepts were out there. People are taken aback, and I think what the internet has done is it's just exposed the social normatives have always existed there, but we just don't openly address. It's kind of like you don't talk about, you know, that one uncle because he's, you know, a scumbag. Everyone knows that he's a scammer or whatever, but you just don't talk about it. It's like very open secret about society at large. And I think that's what the recent election has exposed, is that we've always been this way. We always talk like this, but we just don't discuss it, if you will. And it just, all the tea got spilt. I think the open secret, if you will, is now being discussed and talked about and being recognized and acknowledged, if you will. Okay, so going on with the article here. Because this message unrolls more like a State of the Union address than your typical Facebook post, it would undoubtedly fuel speculation that the young Zuckerberg may be positioning himself to run for public office. By the way, he turns 35, the minimum age of a U.S. president, in 2019. While Wyatt said that might well be a demotion, it's true that one could dismiss Facebook as a global power with Stalin lying to Churchill. How many divisions does the Pope have? But Facebook has a foreign policy. In the last year alone, Zuckerberg has met with dozens of world leaders, including the Pope.
And Facebook's algorithms determine what information we see and who gets to share our news with us, and the majority of its 1.8 billion users show that they're supportive of it. In essence, they vote for it by using the service every day. Nonetheless, you might consider Zuckerberg's post a counterpoint to the dark inauguration speech we recently witnessed. Unlike the one in D.C., Zuckerberg has specifics. It outlines a collaborative effort, with Facebook taking the initiative to build a global set of meaningful communities with five purposes: support, safety, trusted and open information, and civic engagement and inclusion. So one of the big questions people are thinking about, not just at Facebook, but across the world, is there all this division in the world, Zuckerberg told me. What can we at Facebook be doing that this would be more productive to bring people together? Though he sees his vision statement on the scale of his letter to shareholders at Facebook's IPO 5 years ago, which set out the company's purpose and defined its North Star of sharing, this letter is something different. It's a position paper for the world more broadly, defining a gap in what we need to get along with each other and suggests how social infrastructures and technology can address it. I think of this as more about our view on what needs to get built in the world and where some of the stuff that we're doing might be causing issues that we need to mitigate, he said, his voice burning with intensity. He took me through his pillars of community point by point, using some of the language that would later appear in his post. And this kind of goes on, breaking down about it. It's a fascinating read. There's a couple of points that I'm going to just read from this article here. It's quite a bit long. Zuckerberg's views on informed communities and how they get their news go well beyond the fake news controversy that have bedeviled the company recently. The CEO himself admits that he didn't help things by saying at a conference right after the election that he didn't think fake news on his service affected the outcome. I might have messed that one up, but not given the broader context, people thought that the narrow thing was how I think about this broadly, he said. The question of common understanding and common ground is even bigger. Let's say you can wave a magic wand and get rid of all the misinformation. We could still be moving into a world where people are so polarized that they will use a completely different set of true facts to paint whatever narrative they want to fit their worldview. I told Zuckerberg that right now my newsfeed basically is Trump, 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 married, Trump, baby, Trump. I wonder how much of his newsfeed has dominated by posts about our new president, and is a good amount, he said. So that's from Black Channel, Back Channel. This one is a little more of a screed, if you will, by Linode Brzezinski from Bloomberg. Facebook plans to rewire your life and be afraid. Facebook founder Mark Zuckerberg's manifesto, penned clearly in response to accusations leveled at the social network in the wake of the bitter U.S. election campaign, is a scary dystopian document. It shows that Facebook launched, in Zuckerberg's own words, 5 years ago, to extend people's capacity to build and maintain relationships, is turning to something of an extraterrestrial state run by a small, unelected government that relies extensively on privately held algorithms for social engineering. In 2012, Zuckerberg addressed future Facebook investors in a letter attached to the company's initial public offering prospects. It is how he described the company's purpose. People sharing more, even if it's just with their close friends or families, create a more open culture and leads to a better understanding of the lives and perspective of others. We believe that this creates a greater number of stronger relationships between people and that it helps people get exposed to a greater number of diverse perspectives. By helping people form these connections, we hope to rewire the way people spread and consume information. We think the world's information infrastructure should resemble the social graph, a network built from the bottom up or peer-to-peer rather than a monolithic top-down structure that has existed today. We also believe that giving people control over what they share is a fundamental principle of this rewiring. Whatever those beliefs were based on, they have largely failed the test of time. Instead of creating a stronger relationship, Facebook has spawned anxieties and addiction that are subject of academic studies from Portugal to Australia. Some studies have determined that using Facebook distracts from users' life satisfaction. A Danish experiment in 2015 involving people weaned from Facebook for a week and a control group that kept using it showed that people on the social network are 55% more likely to feel stress. One of the sources of that stress is envy of the glossified lives reported by others. Users' well-being, researchers have shown, only tends to increase when they have meaningful interactions, such as long message exchanges with those who are already close to them. In his latest manifesto, Zuckerberg used parenting groups as an example of something his company does right.
But recent research shows that new mothers use Facebook to obtain validation of their self-perception as good parents, and failing to get enough such validation causes depressive symptoms. As for the rewired information infrastructure, it helps to chase people into ideological silos and feed them content that reinforces confirmation bias. Facebook actively created the silos by fine-tuning the algorithm that lies at its center, the one that forms a user's new feed. The algorithm prioritizes what shows a user's base in large measure on how many times a user has recently interacted with a poster, on the number of likes and comments the post has garnered. In other words, it stresses the most emotionally engaging posts from people to whom you are drawn during the election campaign, a recipe for filtered bubbles, and what's more for amplifying emotional rather than rational arguments. Bragging in his new manifesto, Zuckerberg writes, "In recent campaigns around the world, from India and Indonesia across Europe to the United States, we have seen the candidate with the largest, most engaged following on Facebook usually wins. In the Netherlands today, Liberal Prime Minister Mark Rutte's page has 17,525 likes. That of fiery nationalist Geert Wilders, 1,740K. In France, rationalist Emmanuel Macron has 165,000 likes, while far-right Marine Le Pen boasts 1.2 million. Helping them win is hardly something that would make Zuckerberg a liberal proud, but with his algorithm interface and what people can see on his network, he has created a powerful tool for populists. Zuckerberg doesn't want to correct this mistake and stop messing with people see on the social network. Instead, the new manifesto talks about Facebook as if it were a country or a sub-rational block rather than just a communication-enabling technology. Zuckerberg describes how Facebook sorts groups into meaningful and presumably meaningless ones. Instead of facilitating communication among people who are already part of the social support groups offline, he wants to project Facebook's relationship into the real world. Clearly, that's a more effective way of keeping the competitors at bay. The Facebook chief executive says his team is making an artificial intelligence that will be able to flag posts, contain offensive information, nudity, violence, hate speech, and pass them on for final decision by humans. If past experience is any indication, the overtaxed humans will merely rubber stamp most decisions made by technology, which Zuckerberg makes is still highly imperfect. Zuckerberg also suggests enabling every user to apply filters provided by his technology. Where is your line of nudity, on violence, on graphic content, on profanity? What you decide will be your personal settings. We will periodically ask you these questions to increase participation, so you don't need to dig around to find them. For those who don't make a decision, the default will be whatever the majority of the people in your region selected, like a referendum. Of course, you will always be free to update your personal settings anytime. The real-life effect will be, able, like most users, too lazy to muck around with settings, will accept the majority standard, make it even less likely that anything they see would jar them out of their comfort zone. Those who use the filters won't be much better off. They'll have no idea what is being filtered out because Facebook algorithms are a black box. So Zuckerberg casts Facebook as a global community that needs better policing, governance, nudging towards better social practices. He's willing to allow some democracy and referendums, but the company will make the ultimate decision on the type of content people should see based on the behavior on Facebook. Ultimately, the kind of social engineering affects people's moods and behaviors. It can drive them towards a commercial interaction or stimulate giving to good causes, but it can also spill out in the real world in more troubling ways. It's served to expect humility from Silicon Valley heroes, but Zuckerberg should realize that trying to shape how people use Facebook may be creating a monster. His companies, other services like Messenger and WhatsApp, merely allow users to communicate without any interference. And that simple function is the source of the least controversial examples in Zuckerberg's manifesto. In Kenya, whole villagers are in WhatsApp groups together, including the representatives. The Facebook CEO writes, "Well, so are my kids' schoolmates, and that's great. People are grateful for tools that help them work, study, do things together, but they respond to shepherding in unpredicted ways. Virtual identity suicide is one. The trend doesn't show up in Facebook's report usage numbers, but that might be something a lot of the active users the company reports are actually bots. If you type 'how to leave' into Google search windows, you have to 'how to leave Facebook' will be the first suggestion." So there's that. And then here's the last bit, if you will. This is written by Arl Balkan. He is a cyborg rights activist, as he writes. "Do not track is better in privacy tool for Safari on iPhone, iPad, and Mac. It protects you from behavior ads and companies that track you on the web," is one of the things that's posted on top of his website. This article is called "Encouraging Individual Sovereignty in a Healthy Commons." Mark Zuckerberg's manifesto outlines his vision of a
centralized global colony ruled by Silicon Valley oligarchy. I say we must do the exact opposite and create a world with individual sovereignty and a healthy commons. Mark Zuckerberg has released a manifesto titled Building Global Community, in which he details how he one of the top 8 billionaires in the world, and his Byzantine American multinational corporation, Facebook Incorporated, are going to solve all the world's problems. In this grand vision for humanity, Mark keeps returning to how Facebook fundamentally brings us closer together by connecting friends and family. What Mark fails to mention is that Facebook does not connect people together. Facebook connects people to Facebook Incorporated. This is true. Mark's Facebook the myth. Mark wants you to think Facebook connects you to each other. Facebook the reality. Facebook connects you to the Facebook Incorporated. Facebook business model is the man in the middle, to track every move you, your family, and your friends make, to store all the information indefinitely and continuously, analyze, understand you better in order to exploit you by manipulating you for financial and political gain. Facebook isn't a social network, it's a scanner that digests human beings. It is, for all intents and purposes, a camera that captures your soul. Facebook business is to simulate you and to own and control your simulation, thereby owning and controlling you. I call this business model for Facebook, Google, and the venture capital-funded long-tail Silicon Valley startups, people farming. Facebook is a factory farm for human beings, and Mark's manifesto is nothing more than a panic billionaire's latest sophomoric attempt to decorate an unpalatable business model grounded in the abuse of human rights with a fax moral purpose to stave off regulation and justify what is unabashedly a colonial desire to create a global fiefdom by connection of all of us to Facebook Incorporated. Oh, I forgot that line. Avoiding a global colony. Mark's manifesto isn't about building a global community, it's about building a global colony, with himself as king, with his corporation and the Silicon Valley oligarchy as the court. It's not the job of the corporation to develop the social infrastructure for community, as Mark wants to do. Social infrastructure must belong to the commons, not the giant monolithic corporations like Facebook. The reason we find ourselves in this mess is ubiquitous surveillance, filter bubbles, and fake news propaganda is precisely due to the utter and complete destruction of the public sphere by an oligarchy of private infrastructures that pose a public space. Facebook wants us to think that it's park when it's actually a shopping mall. The last thing we need is more privately owned, centralized digital infrastructures to solve the problem created by an unprecedented concentration of power, wealth, and control in a tiny number of hands. It's way past time we started funding and building the digital equivalents of parks in the digital age instead of building ever larger shopping malls. Others have written detailed critiques of Mark's manifesto. I will not repeat their efforts here. Instead, I want to focus on how we can build a world that stands in stark contrast to one of Mark's vision, a world in which we individuals, instead of corporations, have ownership and control over ourselves. In other words, where we have individual sovereignty. Where Mark asks you to trust him to be a benevolent king, I say let's build a world without kings. Where Mark's vision is rooted in colonialism and the perpetuation of centralized power and control, mine is based on individual sovereignty and a healthy distributed commons. Individual sovereignty and the cyborg self. We can no longer afford the luxury of not understanding the nature of self in the digital age. The very existence of our freedoms and democracy would depend on it. We are, and we have been, for a while now, cyborgs. In that, I mean to conjure up the stereotypical representation of cyborgs as a prevalent in the science fiction where technology is implanted within biological tissue. Instead, I offer a more general definition, which the term applies to any extension of our minds and our biology self using technology. While technology implants are certainly feasible, possible, and demonstrable, the main way in which we extend ourselves with technology today is through the implants but explants. We are shared beings. The sum total of our various aspects are contained within our biological beings, as well as the myriad of technology that we use to extend our biological abilities. Once we understand this and follow that, we must extend the protections of the self beyond our biological borders to encourage those technologies encompassed by those technologies by which we extend ourselves. Wherefore, any attempt to own, control, and trade in these technologies by third parties in its attempt to own, control, and trade in the constitutional elements of people. It is, in short, an attempt to own, control, and trade in people. Needless to say, we must resist any attempt to reduce people to property with the greater of fear. For those to do so is to give our tacit consent to a new slavery, one in which we do not trade in biological aspects of human beings, but the digital aspects. Two, of course, do not exist apart and are not truly separable when manipulation was necessary affects the other. I've heard this argument before, but I think this is something that is very understandable. Basically, our digital selves are ourselves as well, and, you know, it's a form of slavery. It's a form of taking ownership of a personhood of someone if you control their digital asset, if you will. And I think this is a very important argument. I understand it's very complicated given the history of the United States in particular when it comes to slavery and the issue of slavery and the fact that what is not being addressed in this country and its the history of it, the manifestation of it, the economic power of slavery, how everything pretty much in America was built as a result of slavery. You know, using this argument is a little problematic, but it's apropos to the situation because it is literally what it is. You're labeling what is occurring for what it actually is. So beyond surveillance capitalism, once we understand that our relationship to technology is not one of the master butler but cyborg origin or organ, once we understand that we sin ourselves with technology and that our technology and data lie within the boundaries of self, then we must insist that the constitutional protection of the self that we have enshrined within the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the implementation within our myriad of national laws are extended to protect the cyborg self. It also follows that any attempt to violate the boundaries of self must be considered an assault on the cyborg self. Exactly this abuse that constitutes the everyday business model of Facebook, Google, and mainstream Silicon Valley-inspired technology today. In this model, which Shoshun Sumber calls surveillance capitalism, what we have lost is the individual sovereignty. People have once again become property of it in the digital, not biological form. To counter this, we must build new infrastructures to enable people to regain individual sovereignty. Those aspects of the infrastructure that concerns the world around us must belong to the commons and those parts that concern people. They make us the organs of our cyborg selves and must be owned and controlled by the individual. So, for example, smart city architecture must be in commons and data around the world around us, data about rocks, must belong to the commons, while your smart car, smartphone, smartwatch, smart teddy bear, etc., and the data they collect, data about people, must belong to you. Imagine a world where everyone has their own space on the internet funded from the commons. This is a private space, an organ of the cyborg self that our so-called smart devices and all organs link into. Instead of thinking of space as a personal cloud, we must consider it a special permanent node within a peer-to-peer structure wherein all various devices, organs connect to one another. Pragmatically, this permanent node is used to guarantee findability, initially using domain names and availability as it's hosted always on, as we transit from the client-server architecture of the current web to the peer-to-peer architect of the next generation internet. We're going to talk about one of those type of infrastructures when we talk about build your own. Infrastructures we build must be funded from the commons, belonging to the commons, and be interpersonable. These services themselves must be constructed and hosted by a plethora of individual organizations, not governments or corporate behemoths, working with interoperable protocols and competing to provide the best service possible to people they serve. Not coincidentally, the severely limited scope of corporate functions marks the entirety of a corporation role within a democracy as I see it. The sole purpose of a corporation should be to compete with other organizations to provide the best service to the people it serves. This is a stark contrast to the wide remit corporations have today to attract people whom they call users under the false pretense free service when they are the product being sold, only to addict them and trap them with lock-in using proprietary technology, farm them, manipulate their behavior, and exploit them for financial and political gain. In the corporations of today, we individuals serve corporations. In the democracy of tomorrow, corporations must serve us. The service provider must, of course, be free to extend the capacity of the system as long as they share the improvement back to the commons, share alike, thus avoiding lock-ins. For providing services above and beyond the core service funding from commons, individual organizations may set prices for and charge for value-added services. In this way, we can build a healthy economy of competition on top of an ethically sound core and self of the system monopolies we have today on top of an ethically rotten core. And we can do so without embroiling the whole system in a convoluted government bureaucracy that will stifle experimentation, competition, and the organic decentralized evolution of the system. The organic decentralized evolution of the system. Interoperability free as in freedom technology with share-alike licenses, a peer-to-peer architect as opposed to client-server and commons-funded core are the fundamental safeguards for preventing this new system from decaying into a new version of the monopolistic surveillance web we have today. They are how we avoid economies of scale and break the feedback loop between the accumulation of information and the wealth that is the core driver of surveillance capitalism. To be perfectly clear, we are not talking about a system that can flourish under the dictates of a late-stage surveillance capitalism. In this system, however, that we can be constructed under present conditions to act as a bridge from the status quo to a sustainable post-capitalistic world. So basically, this new type of system will be, as it stated, a bridge from the current system to the new system. It's not going to be instantaneous. It's going to be very kind of gradual, and then there will be at one point where it's going to accelerate. And this bridge is strong enough, if the infrastructure is strong enough, if it's sound enough, it will allow people to propel into the new type of system that it will develop. But it's not going to be easy. It's going to actually, there will be some pushback, if you will. Just look what's happening to cryptocurrencies that we speak, and the attack on encryption as a whole. Building the world we want to live in. In a talk I gave at the European Commission event in Rome recently, I told the audience that we must build the world we want to live in. For me, that's not a world owned and controlled by a handful of Silicon Valley oligarchs. In a world with a healthy commons where we, as a community, collectively own and control these aspects of our existence that belong to us and all, and where we as individuals individually own and control these aspects of our existence that belong to ourselves. Imagine a world where you and those you love have democratic agency, where we all enjoy basic welfare, rights, and freedoms, benefit cyborg dignity. Imagine a sustainable world free of the destructive short-term greed of capitalism, where we no longer reward sociopaths for finding every more ruthless and destructive ways to accumulate wealth and power at the expense of everyone else. Imagine a free world removed from the feedback loop of manufactured fear, ubiquitous surveillance, that is spiraling deeper into a fresh vortex of fascism. Imagine a world where we grant ourselves a myriad of intellectual rewards existence, where we are free to explore the potential of our species among the stars. That is the world that I wake up every day to work towards. Not because it's charitable, not because I'm a philanthropist. In fact, for no reason at all other than because that is the world I want to live in. And that is Aurel Balkin. And that is the some of the pushback against Zuckerberg's manifesto. Now on to our next segments. On to build your own. So there I'm going to talk about two build your own projects that you can utilize and do, and I have a link in the show notes. One is Golem, which is a worldwide supercomputer program. The grand vision. Golem is the new way the internet will work. Golem is a global, open-source, decentralized supercomputer that anyone can access. It is made up of the combined power of users' machines from personal laptops to entire data centers. Anyone will be able to use Golem to compute almost any program you can think of, from rendering to research, to running websites, in a completely decentralized and expensive way. The Golem Network is a decentralized sharing economy of computing power where anyone can make money renting out their computing power or developing and selling software. Use cases. A few of the most world-changing ways Golem can be used. Computing graphics. Golem can distribute the task of rendering CGI, doing it in minutes, what takes days or cheaper than anything else. The first version, Brass Golem, will do this only. Businesses. From stock market predictions to big data analysis, Golem can speed up business computations while lowering costs. Machine learning. Whether you're teaching an AI to beat grandmasters or recognizing images or human voice patterns, you can go to Golem to speed up the process. Cryptography. Golem can run the world's first and largest fully decentralized cryptocurrency mining pools. It can also help with cryptography with works with like integer factorization. The world of science can benefit immensely for inexpensive and easy access to a powerful supercomputers, from DNA analysis to protein folding simulations to search for alien life and on. Microservers. The Golem application registry can run countless types of decentralized microservers and dApps, which anyone can be able to develop and share for a profit if they wish. They're just the tip of the iceberg, and Golem is a potential use case, and more will appear as more technology comes to fruition. The worldwide sharing economy of computing power. Golem enables users' applications requesters to rent out cycles of others' provider machines. Any user ranging from a single PC owner to a large data center can contribute resources to Golem Network. Software developers are in the center of Golem's ecosystem. Application, registry, and transaction frameworks enable anyone to deploy and distribute applications in the Golem Network. An Ethereum-based transaction system clears pathways between providers, requesters, and software developers. Technology. Decentralized, secure, and open development. Decentralized and scalable. There's no single point of failure and no trusted authority, even though Golem is capable of connecting millions of nodes using a P2P architecture. Secure. All computations take place in a virtual machine and are fully isolated from the host system. Always open for innovation and integration. Integration. Developers can deploy their own integration on Golem and implement an appropriate monetization mechanism. Features. Golem is being built on some of the world's most cutting-edge technologies. Peer-to-peer network, transaction systems, task definitions, task computation, reputation systems, application registry, and transaction frameworks. You can sign up for Golem's newsletter. They have a blog on Medium. You can contact them. They're on Twitter, Slack, and Reddit. So, build your own is a fascinating project. Just the fact that all these different types of systems, from money to use of a supercomputer to the next system we're going to talk about, decentralizing the cloud, is everyone, because of the way that the internet developed, most importantly, the way governmental and business systems have treated the internet, people are seeking to be more peer-to-peer, sharing economy, just distributing all that information and wealth into a wider variety, so there's greater access for all, but also profit for all, if you will. So storage. I've been following this project ever since it came about. I talked about it on Musings of the Shive. I even interviewed Sean Wilkinson, one of the architects and creators on storage. And basically what it is just a blockchain-based, end-to-end encrypted, distributed object storage where only you have access to your data. So end-to-end encryption, distributed infrastructure, blazing fast, peer-to-peer technology, higher availability, how does it work? Basically, simple pricing, pay only for what you use, no setup fees, no minimum usage, storage is 0.01 15 gigs a month. Bandwidth is 0.05 cents per gig. Free software cloud platform. We're passionate about decentralizing and we love free and open software. Our mission is to rethink cloud storage to provide the security, privacy, and transparency is missing. That's why we're building an open source cloud platform that aims to fundamentally change the way people and devices own. We welcome your feedback, bug reports, and pull requests. So basically, you download the program storage onto your computer, and you basically lease your gigabytes, if you will, to the storage system, and people can store their information in a peer-to-peer manner, all encrypted, so you can have like hundreds of different people utilizing your computer to store the information. You don't have access to it, and no one else has access to it. Only the people that have the private keys, if you will, to that information can access those files. And so it's a way for you to, if you have an extra computer, extra storage space, maybe grab one of those Seagate terabyte hard drives, plug it in, attach it to the internet, download the storage system, and if you have a broadband internet, even better, and bam, you are making money off of a $400 purchase, if you will, through time. Not to mention for your own personal usage, you can store your information through, you know, this cloud system where you don't have to worry about anyone looking at your information, hacking your information, or tracking your information down. So some tech I use. I use one of the Linux operating systems I use is Ubuntu. Is one of the more, I would say, stronger Linux communities. It does everything from cloud to servers to desktop. You can do IoT, mobile. For a while there, they had a phone system going around. You can still do stuff with it yourself, but it's not with any particular company at this time, I believe. So, you know, Ubuntu is an open source software platform that runs from the cloud to the smartphone to all your things. Lets you host your own OpenStack cloud with BootStack. We design, build, and run your private cloud infrastructure without a vendor lock-in. Multiple devices in one place. Ubuntu is a single software platform that runs across smartphones, tablets, and PCs. Designed to help make coverage, computing, and reality one system, one experience, and multiple form factors. For all things, Ubuntu Core develops bulletproof security, reliable updates, and the enormous Ubuntu ecosystem to a wide range of Internet of Things, connected devices, and autonomous machines. It's one of the more easier Linux distributed systems out there. I've been using it since 11, and it's just vastly improved over the last almost 5 to 7 years of my usage of Ubuntu. Currently, 16.04 is out. There should be an update again pretty soon this year. It's easy to navigate, easy to understand. It comes preloaded with like Firefox, Amazon, anything and everything you can think of that you could utilize, from encrypted hard drives to PGP to email services, is all bundled together. If you need to add things to your system, you can do so. There's even an Ubuntu graphic kernel, if you will, if you like to think of it, where you could, it's called Ubuntu Studio, where it has audio editing files, video audio, video files, 3D making, just like if you were into either making games or streaming games and having yourself recorded, or like podcasting, if you will. You can use Audacity or other video services for your YouTube videos. You can easily build and build up, if you will. It is a very fascinating system. Like I said, very easy to use, easy to develop, build off of, and it's open source and it's free to utilize, so you're not paying any type of money at all. And it's just an easier, I think, operating system, and you don't have to worry about somebody taking your information and selling it like Windows, or exposing you to various possibilities of hacks. Not that you can't get hacked with Linux, you can, but it's not to the degree that happens with Mac and Windows, if you will. The other thing is tech that you can support and use is Brave Browser. It's just a free open browser system that's security emphasis, has a strong security emphasis. It also has an integration with Bitcoin. So I'm going to read from the site. Browse faster and safer with Brave. The new Brave browser automatically blocks ads and trackers, making it faster and safer than your current browser. Start supporting publishers today with our new Brave payment system, so you can load up Brave, if you will, with like $5 in Bitcoin. And every time you go to a certain website, you can say, hey, give this website like 5 cents or 10 cents or a penny every time you go. And then that website can collect that payment from you, or it automatically goes into their particular wallet, if you will. Browse faster. Brave blocks trackers and intrusive ads that can slow you down on the web. Keeps your information safe, effective, shielded from third-party tracking and malwareism, which is the adware that's built with malware that either tracks you down, or can you get ransomware, or just all sorts of creepy and horrible things that can happen to your computer. For Brave, you can choose whether to see ads to respect your privacy or pay sites directly. Either way, you can feel good about helping fund content creators. It's amazing how fast your pages load when you strip away everything but the real content. Up a whopping 60% of pages load time is caused by the underlying ad technology that loads into various places each time you hit a page on your favorite news site. And 20% of this time is spent on loading things that are trying to learn more about you. So you can watch the video and try to breaks down what it is. I personally use it on my phone. Brave redirects to HTTPS. We've integrated HTTPS everywhere into every Brave browser to make sure you're always moving your bits across the safest possible pipe. Brave blocks tracking pixels and tracking cookies. Brave is open source, so it's free to utilize. You can examine the code. You can join us on GitHub and contribute to Brave, as well as build the web of the future. It's available for iOS, Android, OS, X machines, and Linux.
So thank you for listening to the show, and until next time.
Thank you for listening. Please rate and review either through iTunes or Stitchers or any of the podcasting apps that you're currently using to listen to this show. Thank you, and until next time.
This has been a Hiroshi Shine Space Odyssey Network production.